We're talking about agendas, like I even try to give the government the benefit of the doubt here. Like a lot of people are saying like, oh, any government regulation is evil because a hidden agenda of control and power and greed and all this. But I think they honestly have our best interests in mind. But that makes them even more dangerous than they would be if they did have a hidden agenda of destroying Bitcoin and maintaining this tyrannical control, because that means they're probably even less likely to listen to us because they think they know what's best for us, and that any suggestions we give them wouldn't be as good as what they could provide if we would just get out of the way, right? Because we're not smart enough to take care of ourselves. That's why they're there. So
We're
they
helpless
genu
consumers. We need protection.
exactly, like they genuinely believe that they're protecting us, so they're gonna be very reluctant to be flexible on anything regarding their regulation. So, and they're ultimately they're going to pass something that benefits them the most. And that's how it always happens when you're dealing with politicians. It's you lose every single time because they're not going to agree with anything unless it benefits them more than it benefits you. And that's exactly what's going to happen with we have Bitcoin Foundation abandoning their original mission and putting all their money into politics. We have the Chamber of Digital Commerce coming up with the sole purpose of lobbying governments in the US. All this money in the Bitcoin community is going towards, the political machine, but they're engaging in a game that's impossible to win because the politicians and the regulators aren't going to give ground unless they win, and they do that because they think that we're too stupid to take care of ourselves and that they have to be there to baby us and make sure we don't hurt ourselves.
What do you think about the theory that like maybe part of the motivation for the BitLicense is to allow banks to get their fingers more into Bitcoin, and that it's partially crafted to benefit not just the regulators like Ben Lasky, who wants to appear like he's doing his job well and wants to get a fat salary from the governor, but also that that banks want to see this benefit them as well. They want to be able to deal with these companies in New York on a very, very close basis, and the banks feel that the only way to do that is to regulate Bitcoin like they're regulated, you know?
Yeah, I mean, definitely the banks would want to profit off this because they can see that people are getting rich off of Bitcoin, so why shouldn't they? And the DFS is just it's just like a middle point between the government and the banks. So I'm sure the banks have like a direct line with Ben Lasky, and they're like, "No, we need you to do this with the regulation. We need you to do that with the regulation, because it'll hurt us this way, or it'll benefit us that way." It's like,
I'm sure
I
banks are
mean,
submitting their public comments as well, and those probably go to the top of the top of consideration for Ben Lasky.
yeah, I mean, it's no different from any kind of political agency, government agency. Like, if the money's there. And banks have a lot of money because they're banks, so definitely they're gonna try to spin it so they get something from it.
So the comment period is extended to October 21st, and following that, at that point, Ben Lasky will release their changes that they decided on. Like, who knows what they're going to take out, but I'm sure they're going to take out something that people hate, and they're going to appear like they're good guys kind of because they mercifully took away one of the destructive provisions while keeping in most of everything else that's horrible. So it's going to appear like a small victory for the community. So then after that change implementation, there's going to be a 30-day review process to review the changes and allow Actually, I'm not sure if there's going to be an additional 45 days after that to allow businesses time to comply. I think there might be. And then after that, like the regulations will be completely in effect and your business better be complying or else, all your lawyers in your company are going to be very stressed out. And, there's going to be a small possibility that Ben Lasky's agents are going to come knocking at your door, demanding you close down or something or pay a fine. I don't know. But after that, it's going to be official. We're approaching that time very quickly. I can see, one of the possible benefits out of this is if this does make banks more comfortable with Bitcoin, then they're going to be more likely to dump a lot of money into it, and then we can see a price rise afterwards. Which, in my mind, I think that might be part of the goal of a lot of these people who have political inclinations. They know that the banks are highly politicized and highly regulated, and the only way to get the banks on board with all of their, billions and billions of dollars is to get Bitcoin regulated too. So I think that's part of the goal as
Yeah,
well.
that would be dangerous though, because if you get a large chunk of the Bitcoin price determined by money from banks, well then you have Bitcoin directly tied to the Federal Reserve. We know how great the Federal Reserve has been for the past 100 years, so.
Well, then, I mean, well, yeah, not directly per se, but kind of like 2 degrees of separation. The feds use quantitative easing to pump money into the banks, give them loans at zero interest and stuff like that. And then from there, if the banks have an easy channel for investing into Bitcoin related assets and companies and such, then we could see like maybe quantitative easing flowing like almost directly into Bitcoin, which w that would make the price go up, right, of Bitcoin. It would just more quickly lead to inflation,
Yeah,
which quantitative easing is doing.
it would expand the business cycle into Bitcoin. So we would have these massive increases in the value of Bitcoin. People would get rich off of it. But then once the easy money got shut off, like it did in 2008, it would all come crashing down, just like the rest of the economy did. And that would be really bad. I don't think Bitcoin would be able to survive that, just because it's so new, and its foundation is like really small right now. It has nowhere near the support of the, broader economy.
Yeah,
So.
at the very least, it would increase volatility a lot, like a lot. As much as Bitcoin is volatile right now, just imagine how volatile it could be if you have easy Fed money and easy bank money flowing into it and flowing out of it, on a daily basis. Like, holy crap, we like imagine volatility on the scale of, one day Bitcoin is worth $2,000, the next day it's worth 2,500, the next day it's worth 1,500. Like this is the crazy volatility that we might see in the future if quantitative easing and Fed policy is more closely linked to Bitcoin by way of banks and Wall Street and the New York Department of Financial Services. It'll be exciting, right? It'll be exciting at
Yeah.
least if people can handle that kind of volatility.
It'll be interesting to watch, but definitely no good can come from this kind of regulation. Like we can get it as painless as possible, but once it's passed, it's definitely going to hurt Bitcoin
Yeah,
at
well,
to some
in the short
degree,
term, you know,
to
it,
some degree.
yeah, it just in New York mainly, and like everyone else, we've talked about this before. Everyone else in the world can just completely ignore New York's regulations and still be pretty much fine. And ignore not just the regulations, but ignore people in New York who might be your potential customers. It'll be more worth it to block their IP addresses than trying to comply with the BitLicense regulations. So, it's going to happen either way. We need to look at the silver lining and figure out how we're going to react as a community to it. And if we're just going to keep doing the same thing, and ignore the regulations or not. It's coming. It's coming soon, and I'm really curious now to see what happens in this space concerning the price, mainly if what the bit license how that might affect the price. Because we know, yeah, it's going to stifle innovation. We know that. Just give us at least a price increase, maybe. That'd be great. Thanks to the banks.
Yeah, I really don't see, I don't see that much price activity coming from BitLicense. 'Cause I mean the regulation itself doesn't really connect a lot of people, doesn't really connect a lot of the Bitcoin price to banking activity. Actually if the companies aren't allowed to hold Bitcoin profits, they have to like sell at the dollars. Wouldn't that actually generate, downward pressure on the price? Because
Oh yeah.
you'd have all these companies in New York. The one I'm thinking about is the ITBIT exchange, which apparently is, growing. So you would have that exchange pumping huge amounts of Bitcoin or dumping huge amounts of Bitcoin onto the market. So, but. And
Yeah.
I don't see, maybe like in the future the banks would get really involved with it, which would, tie it to the Fed's monetary policy. But that's like worst case scenario, like extreme consequence. I don't really see that happening with this version of BitLicense. Maybe with later versions and, future amendments and things like that.